we have to respect that kids will always find novel ways to break the rules, novel ways to get in trouble, novel ways to just be kids. And cell phones have provided a new mechanism for that, but they haven't come up with new ideas yet. It's the same behavior in a new way.
At what age is it appropriate for children to have a phone? When should they be allowed to be on social media? Technology can be confusing, but today we have some answers. We'll talk to a school psychologist about recommendations for technology use and talking to your children about the pitfalls of using the internet, now on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. We're here to discuss kids and technology, especially the roles our devices play in our lives. Our relationship with technology is fraught with contradictions. It has the potential to do so much good and make our lives so much easier. Yet, there are dangers and pitfalls to almost everything we do online. Joining us today to discuss all things children, technology, and mental health is New Hampshire School Psychologist and past School Psychologist of the Year, Dr. Nate Jones. Nate, welcome to The State We're In. Thank you so much for joining us. When it comes to cell phones, how are elementary schools generally dealing with them, and what are the typical guidelines?
That's an excellent place to start and a really important question. And I want to first start by saying, too, I want to thank the Governor Wentworth School District, which is where I'm sitting today, where I've been speaking with both some elementary and some middle school, high school educators about some of these topics and how we can best address them. And so it's great to see this school district and all the school districts in the state are actively working on this, and we see changes all the time. And I think for elementary schools, we typically are seeing really more prohibitions and kids just not being allowed to have phones, at least in the building. So typically they're staying in the backpack, staying in pockets or clothes. So kids certainly do have phones in elementary school, at least some of the kids, but we're more often seeing them put away and not really being used. In contrast though, we are seeing them on school buses, and we're seeing a lot of difficulty with elementary students using phones interactively outside the building. And so it's been a lot of work that's been a challenge for schools. There's understanding discipline code and how far the discipline code can go when it comes to their students interacting with each other about school or non-school related topics through technology outside the building. Because at some point, I mean, elementary school kids are still little kids and they tend to make some mistakes. And there's been a lot of work that hasn't had been done about how to best address the mistakes that can get made with technology with our youngest kids.
A quick follow-up on that. Is it when schools are, especially at the elementary school level, when they're making these decisions for kids to, you know, leave their devices in their backpacks or use them on the bus or whatever, is it more about, you know, the natural distraction that might come from having these devices in school? Or is it about that piece of, you know, kind of guarding them a little bit about what they might get into online if they had their devices?
I think it's both. At the younger level, I'm more about some of the just distraction of the phones. I mean, you know, if a fourth grader brings out a phone in pretty much every environment and more or less attracts every other fourth grader within about 30 feet. So they are extraordinarily distracting. And the inappropriate content and the dangers of the content is always a huge concern, especially again with the youngest kids. Hopefully, and I think more often we see parents having put some of the parental restrictions on the devices for those students. But at some point, I think for schools, is just, you know, it doesn't take long for a phone to be distracting the entire class. And so really this, they can't be out to the point that they would become problematic because they are so amazingly distracting to little kids.
And so what about the older kids then in middle school or high school? What are we seeing there?
Yeah, and it changes because certainly, especially by the time we get to high school, almost every student has a phone. In middle school, you see a huge variety. You see some students with the newest, latest, and greatest. You see some students with old school flip phones. You see students with just a watch on or all sorts of varying technology. There is more use of technology in learning, especially at the high school level. We see high school teachers having students look information up on their phone, use functions like calculators and other apps on the phone at times. Also, though, I've been seeing in the schools I visit more and more restrictions. And certainly, like one of the schools I used to go to a lot, the guest Wi-Fi was more or less open. And so all the students were on Wi-Fi all day and could use their phones because reception is no good. Well, now they just put a password on Wi-Fi and those students all no longer have access. And that certainly caused some consternation, but also sort of decreased phone use. And it was paired with a stronger policy about having phones have to put away. So I think that we're seeing them incorporating learning at the high school level. We're seeing greater restrictions on them, but we're also seeing a pretty inconsistent implementation of those restrictions. So it varies widely town to town. It varies widely within buildings within towns. So it's still definitely the Wild West when it comes to phones. But I think if anything, we're seeing the movement towards less and less cell phones in schools.
So how do you balance policies about focusing on school with school safety when it comes to cell phones? With the current climate, so many parents are worried about being able to reach their kids or for their kids to reach them in an emergency. So how do schools balance those kinds of competing interests?
It's a very challenging question. And I think the first thing we want to say is that schools are an incredibly safe place to be and are becoming safer all the time. And, you know, millions of kids go to school every day in this country, and educators are working every day to ensure safety. And I think, you know, every educator, we all have the same nightmares and we're all terrified of the same things. And so much work is done within school buildings to promote safety. And that's a really important thing to always remind ourselves of, and always remind families of, and remind the students of, and it's the importance of when crises happen, and they do, to listen to your teachers. That's the first move. Not be on your phone, not be on media, but to really pay attention to what you're being told by your teachers and follow directions. That's how keeps everybody safe. At the same time, crises are crises. And so we're looking for balance. We're probably never going to find it. Because when a crisis happens, whether it's a family crisis or a school crisis, people want to feel better. And connection helps us feel better, and cell phones allow us to connect. And so they're not going away. The internet, social media, cell phones are here to stay. And schools are just having to adapt and evolve and manage our crisis plans. And so I think that there's a few things we can think of, though, because we want to differentiate between crises and inconveniences. So it can be a crisis if someone is in the hospital. It can be a crisis if there's a threat at school. It is not a crisis if you forgot your soccer cleats. And so we have to differentiate that, and that can become a real challenge, both for students who can feel a strong need to reach out to their family about something that other folks might not think are crises, but the student feels is a crisis, which you want to respect that, certainly. For families who want to reach their own children about crises and or about inconveniences. And so it's never a great answer. I have certainly seen schools implement rules where you can come down to the office and reach out to your family, no problem, but you have to come down to the office and do it in a time when you have a moment, when you have free time during the day, not during math instruction. And other schools I've seen be less structured in it. So I think that we probably would never find the right balance, and each school will do it differently, but it's here to stay.
Yeah. What effect can phones have on the behavior of kids? Most kids have access to computers with many similar features. Is having a cell phone different in some way?
Sure. And yes, is the short answer. But at the same time, behavior is behavior. And we hear a lot of the kids these days talk. Like, it comes up all the time, especially when it comes to phones. And what I always remember when we hear the kids these days conversations is a great quote about how kids love luxury and won't mind their elders and have no manners from Socrates, 2,500 years ago. And so kids these days have been kids these days for an awful long time. And we have to respect that kids will always find novel ways to break the rules, novel ways to get in trouble, novel ways to just be kids. And cell phones have provided a new mechanism for that, but they haven't come up with new ideas yet. It's the same behavior in a new way. And so I think that we want to keep responding, because healthy habits are still healthy habits. A good routine, going to sleep at the same time of the day, having regular meals, exercise, extracurriculars, it's time with your friends, going to school every day. These continue to be the things that promote health. And where cell phones can interfere with behavior is when cell phones start interfering with those healthy habits, those protective factors. But on the flip side, they also can promote. A lot of folks watching are probably seeing the Surgeon General's report about loneliness and the dangers of loneliness and making loneliness akin to smoking because of its impact on individuals, its impact on the health system's cost. And When going well, cell phones can be an amazing way to communicate with other people and maintain connections and to grow skills and to learn new things. But they have the opposite downsides as well. They can be distracting. Like I said, with our youngest students, a cell phone in the fourth grade class, you can't teach anymore. By the time you get to ninth to 12th grade, there might be a cell phone out and it just distracts the one student. But it still distracts the one student. Then there's big mental health downsides, which we're going to get to, but we know of the bullying, the harassment, the finding inappropriate images online, sharing inappropriate images online. So I think, you know, I know when I think back, I'm awful glad that my entire childhood wasn't recorded on video by my friends. And it is now. And I've worked, you know, too many cases where, you know, a child did some dumb thing a kid might do, but it was recorded by one of their friends and shared. And has then become a huge controversy and a huge distraction and a huge, you know, potentially harmful event for that child. And so they can have a huge impact on mental health and behavior. But at the same time, we have to keep responding like we know how to respond. And schools are really good at responding to behavior. We're very good at it. So we have to keep with what we know, because we know it does work.
Well, so what are some good rules to have for kids when it comes to technology and the use of social media? And does that change for different age groups? And can you give some good examples?
Sure. And the first thing is, you know, every family is different and every child is different. So every situation is different. So there's really, I only know one rule. The rest are more or less guidelines. But the one rule to me is talk about it. We have to talk about it with our kids. And for schools, we have to talk about it with our students. And the conversations have to be ongoing. It can't be, we did it once when they were seven and we're good now. We have to have the conversations all the time. And we're going to get to that in a minute, what the conversations can be like. But aside from that one rule, in terms of some guidelines, first thing I might say is the American Psychological Association actually just, I think yesterday or the day before, released a health alert about social media, which contains some great guidance in it. So I certainly encourage people to go reference that document and some reporting around it. But also the basic things like phones should be charged, not in bedrooms. I know lots of kids use their phones for an alarm clock, and that can be a challenge. But, you know, charging phones in the living room overnight. Keeping kids off social media when they're young. Yes, your 8-year-old might have a phone if that's a decision you've made, but let's keep the social media back. Now, I mean, I've seen reports of keeping social media back till children are 16, which is no way the norm right now, but that's what some folks have said. Certainly holding on to social media. Passcodes, making sure you know your child's passcode, because if your child changes their passcode and you can't get into the device anymore, that's a red flag. That would be a concern for me. You know, not using phones during mealtimes. That's an important thing, but it also impacts parents because kids do what we do, right? And so a lot of times some of the rules, not using your phone during school, well, it's like not using a phone during work. And so we're going to have rules for our children. There has become an important question of how much do we also abide by those same rules.
Just to follow up on something you said there, so the idea of, you know, let's say keeping children off of social media until they're 16, can we unpack that a little bit and sort of the reasoning behind that? And my guess is that it goes back to something else you were saying, is that, you know, kind of allowing them to develop those real world relationships. But can you talk about that a little bit? Like, why is that important? Why would that be something that parents might want to consider?
Right. Well, I think a lot of it is the downsides. There are massive downsides to social media around bullying, harassment, physical characteristic comparisons, you know, beauty comparisons, used a lot of some of the new filters that are coming out that can make people look like, you know, supermodels at 7 a.m. if you put the right filter on. And the younger we are, the harder time we have understanding the differences between what we see on social media and what someone's real life might be. There's a lot of, you know, cognitive biases that come in that I say the one picture that looks like this person's having this amazing life and really they're not, it's just in their backyard. Or whatever the case may be, the younger we are, the harder time we have understanding and making some of those critical decisions about what we're seeing online. And also the greater likelihood we have of posting, sharing things that we probably shouldn't have. And the mistakes that I've seen in schools, not infrequently, about, you know, the downsides of things kids have shared online. And more often than not, the student is kind of knew they shouldn't have, but doesn't really understand. I thought it'd be okay, or thought just one friend would see it. And so there was a voice, they had the voice in their head to know maybe I shouldn't. So it's not like they didn't have an idea. They had some idea, but they did it anyway, because they're 12 or they're 8 or they're 14. So I think it's both the opportunity to be exposed to potentially harmful aspects of social media and to engage in those, perhaps unintentionally.
So let's go back to talk a little bit about, you know, how can cell phones and other technology, like the use of social media, how does that impact kids' mental health? In what way?
Well, let's start with the positives. You know, I work for a company called Sreskin down in Bedford. It's a nonprofit consortium, and we do a lot of consulting in schools. One of the pieces we always try to push is, you know, positive social emotional competence. And cell phones have the capacity to promote that within our kids. Again, the connections with other people, the use of telehealth, and the fact that you can have a therapy appointment on your phone. And I'm up here at Governor Wentworth today, and I was talking to folks about how a lot of their high school students step out of the parking lot and have their therapy and go back to school again. And they didn't have to get in the car, drive to the therapist's office, do that, come back, maybe get some Dunkin' Donuts, get lunch, and miss the rest of the day. They're able to leave for 40 minutes and come back in and still, you know, receive therapy. There's a, you know, a multitude of smartphone apps, that mindfulness apps, yoga apps, breathing apps, some which are free, and those are certainly ones I'd recommend. Research is still coming in on how effective they are. So there's a lot of potentially positive aspects of technology for mental health. But yeah, there's some downsides. And just some quick data, because we have some data. I'm a school psychologist. You know, is mental health getting worse? I'm asked that all the time. And part of it is no. In general, we think about 1 in 5, 20% of any age, whether it's preschoolers or elderly or anybody in between, have significant impairment from mental health or behavioral health. We're seeing pretty stable rates. ADHD is pretty stable. Depression is more or less stable, but anxiety. Anxiety is changing, we think. And there's new data coming out all the time. This is a study I read from, it was from last year, but I found it recently. I've seen increases in rates. Seeing anxiety going from 5-7% to 8-11% of young people having, you know, clinically impairing anxiety, which I would think jives with most of our experiences. The primary thing that disruptive social media does is it makes us agitated, makes us distressed, it makes us anxious. You might then have a secondary impact of sadness or anger or irritability. But often the first thing we have is that distress, that anxiety about what we saw. And that, I think, becomes the biggest concern, especially with younger kids, when they don't have the emotional insight, the emotional regulation skills, the coping skills yet to manage some of those impacts. And the other piece I want to talk about, which is really important and probably in all this stuff, the one of the things that scares me the most is, you know, the radicalization possibilities, especially for young adolescent boys. And I'm seeing this, and I've seen a bunch of kids with this in the schools, typically high school students. That's sort of the other end of it, where it starts fairly innocuously. You share a meme. You're in a chat group online. You get a meme. You think it's kind of funny, mildly inappropriate, but kind of funny. So you share it. And some kids laugh. We also get some negative feedback. But when you go back to that same online community, you hear the message of, it's not you, it's those folks. They're too sensitive. They don't understand you were joking. They don't understand you like we do. And then through both the algorithmic part of search engines, part of the, you know, New Hampshire is part of the lawsuit against TikTok and others, and also some determined action by some folks online, kids are then exposed to increasingly racist, sexist, otherwise inappropriate, you know, opinions and material. And over time, it can become a stronger and stronger and stronger connection with that online community and the disruptive beliefs that really can change how some kids are over the course of their sort of early adolescence. And it's, I mean, I have early adolescent children, and it's one of the things that scares me, the possibility of that radicalization online, which can begin really, really easy, but it grows slowly.
And so if there is something going on, what are warning signs that parents and teachers can look for, and when should there be concern?
Yep. But just like mental health, it's mental health, and behavior is behavior, and has been since Socrates, warning signs are warning signs. Withdrawing from activities, withdrawing from social relationships, change in the sleep patterns, changes in eating patterns, either more or less, more or less of things, quick changes in friends, these sorts of things are warning signs of something. More technology-specific things, again, like I said, have a known passcode. If all of a sudden your child changes their passcode, If you're out on vacation and your phone's in the car, hey, can I borrow your phone? Take a picture. And you're told no. You can't see. The phones get hidden away. Or if you ask your child or your students to put devices away, and they don't just grumble, because kids might grumble at us, but they get really agitated. They fight back. They put it away for a very short period of time. It has to come out again. That addictive component to technology. Those are all signs that something might be going on, that we want to reach out and potentially consider some help, or at least have some more in-depth conversations with our own kids. And I think the other piece that again tracks back to the radicalization aspect of it, if that might be occurring, it connects to that meme sharing inappropriate content, and also blaming others for their reaction to that content, as opposed to taking the ownership that perhaps I shared something I shouldn't have, or it said something online I shouldn't have. And that's another good warning sign that we need to stop and have some conversations with our kids.
So speaking of those conversations, how do you suggest parents have conversations about the use of screens and online behaviors with their children? What sorts of topics are age appropriate, and how do you start those discussions?
Well, first, start young, like any safety conversation. We always start early. Start way before it's needed. Don't wait till it's needed, right? So you start young, home and school. Schools should be having these conversations as well. And always remember that it's not a friend conversation. It's a parent-to-child conversation. That we're imparting information, we're challenging our kids to grow, we're trying to grow skills, and we're focusing on the safety, the decision-making, the understanding of content and where it might come from. And so, especially when they're younger, it's our own experiences that if you perhaps post something you shouldn't have online, or you read something you think is true and then turns out not to be true, discuss that with your child as a teachable moment, that, hey, this just happened to me. And you point out it could happen to you as well. Make the connection just in brief. Don't have to belabor the point. But starting when we're young and using our own experiences with technology, and again, our own modeling of how we use the technology. But then also talking about things that may or may not apply to parents. The dangers of anonymous posting online, either posting ourselves or reading posts from that are anonymous and unattributed to anybody. The addiction aspect, we're overly addicted to it. Bullying aspect, the chance of receiving or delivering really negative content towards others. I think it's early middle school, especially for kids that access technology, we talk about inappropriate imagery, either viewing it or creating it. And the idea that at any point you may be being recorded by one of your friends, and cell phones are discreet. That's how they're different from computers. They fit in my pocket and I can record you without you knowing, and then share it with people instantaneously, and the dangers that might come along with. And so talking about those, again, those topics early and often, and I think everybody can kind of know their own developmental appropriateness. And again, if a child has disabilities or otherwise has different development from what it would be generally expected, having to adjust when we have conversations, but also not waiting. One of the least informed groups that I work with is teenagers with intellectual disabilities. Because they don't go to health class in school, and there are other things going on in their lives. And so often they don't have information they should have about the dangers of online, dangers of social media, and dangers of phones. But they often receive phones for safety reasons or for communication with their friends and these pieces. So they have technology, but they often are some of the least informed students in the building about the dangers and the safety risks. So.
And I want to go back to where you were talking about if kids are changing their passcodes. And that leads me to wonder about, is there a line, how much do you monitor what your kid is doing online? Do you look in their phone? Do you look through their social media? Do you go through their computer? I mean, is there a line, especially when you do want to have those conversations, you want to build that trust with your child and give them some level of privacy, but also, you want to make sure that you're doing your job as a parent and keeping them safe. So what sort of a good line or rule of thumb there? Where do you fall on that?
Well, on one end, I don't think kids should be forbidden from technology from forever. The never under my roof approach, I don't think is a good one, because eventually our children are going to move out. And if they've never had access to technology until they move out, they haven't learned how to regulate it. So part of it to me is using with our children, having those conversations. So there's a growth opportunity along the way. Another piece that fits into this is recognizing that kids are probably going to make mistakes. Our kids are probably going to lie to us. And I often get in situations with parents who say that, oh, I know my child lies. And we do. We know some of the times our children lie. But almost every time I've been told that by a parent, and when I talk to the kid, I find more ways they've been lying than the parent knows about. Because this is what kids do. And so we have to, I think, have restrictions, recognize our kids are going to try to break them, and anticipate that. Talk to our kids about that openly. Don't make it a secret. Don't make it shameful. Just make it a part of life and have the conversations about it. But again, the way we manage not breaking restrictions, you know, just say no to drugs thing didn't work because it didn't give the alternative. So when we think about restrictions and limiting things, yes, use parental controls. You know, go to the phones and your internet provider and your TV provider, all those things, and turn on all those restrictions at the age appropriate levels as they describe them. Go to the online resources that tell us what age certain materials are appropriate. You know, there's online groups that'll tell you what age certain movies and certain TV shows and certain apps are good for kids. Go read those. But read them with your children. Talk about them with your children. And also talk about what else they can do. Talk about the importance of extracurriculars and exercise and sleep and all these other things. So our kids know not just what they're choosing not to do, but what they're choosing to do instead.
And just again, following up on that point, you know, just as parents, should we be looking through our kids' phones? I mean, should we be looking, what pictures are they taking? Like that, I wonder too about where's the line there, you know, might have privacy, but we also should know what they're doing. You know, what do you think about that?
Yeah, for the younger the child is, the more appropriate it is. You know, below 10, if kids have a technology, I think we have to monitor it extraordinarily carefully. Kids, well, shouldn't be on social media, but even text messaging and pictures and these things. That, and doing it again with them, not after they go to bed at night and sneakily, but sit down with them and talk about it. And so, you know, I know that's how both my children were in fourth grade and did not have phones, but within the context of their fourth grade, it's happened to be fourth grade in their school. There was big inappropriate chat groups that got into some pretty inappropriate conversations that a parent of one of the children in the group found by regularly looking at the chat room and, oh my goodness, what is happening? An iMessage kind of thing. So yeah, below 10, I think we have to be very careful to look at what's going on. From 10 to 14, I think we get progressively more free. And by 14 to 16, I think that's where we are really starting to give our kids that independence, recognizing they may make mistakes. But also, allowing them to have personal property, that even though I may pay the bill, but it's still your personal property unless something goes awry. I think, you know, we have to have some faith in our children, just not too soon. So to me, it's like that 14 to 16 is when I start maybe having more faith. For most kids, every kid is different, but that's maybe my age line when I start to pull back.
And what about being a good digital citizen online in the era of online bullying, trolling, catfishing? How do you talk about the way kids represent themselves online and the impact that can have on their future? I know we talked about that a little bit, and the longevity of some of these decisions.
Right. And that's where that modeling and that discussion of how it goes for us as parents, and especially when things don't go quite right for us as parents with our own online presence and our own online use of media. And because, you know, we can bury people in statistics, but what we know about statistics is if someone disagrees with me and I pile on statistics, they're more likely to get stronger in their own belief than to agree with me. But examples and stories are what change minds. So if we're trying to talk about being a good digital citizen, appropriate online behavior, dangers of anonymous posting, all this stuff, it's the specific examples, especially examples from our own lives, that are going to make that difference. And again, in doing it young, starting in elementary school, before kids have technology, but still had to be a regular part of our conversation as a family or as a class at school, versus waiting until disaster strikes and then trying to go back and teach everything and we assume that they would know.
So do you have any other advice or words of wisdom for parents and educators when it comes to talking with their kids about technology?
You know, I think that a really important point, and I said it earlier, but I want to get back to it, is the not making it shameful piece, not making mistakes shameful. So I'm up here in government work today, and we're talking about doing some behavioral supports for students, and that we don't always get it right, and that we don't get it right trying to get away from it being a single person's fault. It's because you didn't do X correctly. And that's the same for our children. Making it more about the process, the tools that maybe I didn't have parental controls on correctly. We got to fix the parental controls. Maybe this was, you know, so it's more of a it's not your fault. It's something that occurred and we need to learn from and grow from. Because that will also encourage our children to talk about it again in the future. Because what we really don't want is our children to get into a point where they're being bullied or being harassed online, or the opposite, I suppose, they're bullying somebody and us not know about it. We want our kids to always be able to feel safe coming to us. And so to do that, we have to be a safe place for them to come. And I think the other piece is about working with our kids, that it's not just doing those safe choices, being a good citizen, because you might get caught by me as your mom or your dad or by your teacher, you might get in trouble. But getting more of the values aspect of it, you want to be a good citizen online because it's the right thing to do. That's what does good people do. And so shifting away from that punishment oriented, do this or you'll be in trouble, to the make the choice to do this because it's the right choice to make. And so giving the kids the power to make those choices, and giving them the information to make the good ones. But we really want to, if we can empower our kids to be making positive choices through their own healthy habits, that has far more staying power than doing it because if I don't, I'm going to get in trouble when I get home. You know, punishment never taught us anything. The choices and our experiences that will teach us things. So helping kids make the good choices and learn from when we don't happen to make the best one.
New Hampshire school psychologist Dr. Nate Jones, thank you so much for joining us today. The conversation continues online. What worries do you have about your child and technology? We'd love to hear from you. Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag NHTechnology. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.